Let us think of a situation where we are visiting a school. There is a mathematics class going on here. The teacher is trying to teach the concept of addition and subtraction to the third class students. The teacher writes on the blackboard a word problem saying that Ram has about 100 rupees and his father gives him another 20, mother gives him a 10 rupee note. So the students are asked to calculate and add how much money in all does Ram have. But think of a situation here where the students are not able to read what has been written on the blackboard. They are not able to comprehend what the teacher is saying because they are not very efficient in the language in which the teacher is speaking. But as we move on to the history classroom, here the teacher is explaining the Indus Valley Civilization and talks about the reasons why Indus Valley Civilization got extincted. What were the reasons? Was it because of the famine? Was it because of drought? Or what were the other reasons? The teacher is asking the students to explore, to analyze, to understand, and come up with appropriate answers. Here again, we find that some of the students at least are not able to understand what the teacher is saying. I think we can presume that the teacher is speaking in English, but then English is the medium of instruction over here. So what we find is that it's not only that language is important in the Hindi and the English or the Sanskrit classroom, but language plays a very significant role in the understanding of different disciplines. If we feel that language is not important in a science classroom or it is more important in a social science classroom, I think that's not a true understanding. Language becomes the learning tool. In fact, it becomes the bricks and the mortar over which construction of the other layers of a particular building, in this case, the student's knowledge, takes place. So in this program, we are going to discuss how language need not only be seen as confined to Hindi, English, Sanskrit, or any other foreign language, but it needs to be seen as something which cuts across all the disciplines, may they be science, mathematics, or social science. So let's begin with certain formulations about the role of language, which have been captured in a very important document, which is called the National Curriculum Framework. The National Curriculum Framework recognizes that language is not confined to only language teaching. In fact, it cuts across the entire curriculum, and unless the children have these language skills, they will not be able to understand any discipline, whatever it might be. So I think, first of all, let's try to understand what is it that is being said in the National Curriculum Framework document, because that forms the basis of how teachers need to understand the role of language. At the same time, that also forms the basis of how the curriculum in the NCERT curriculum for schools has evolved. It's that understanding which has led to the development of different textbooks as well. So, what is it that the National Curriculum Framework is saying? Language here has been considered as a constellation of skills, which basically means that language comprises of a group of skills, which is reading, writing, listening and speaking. That is what forms the constellation. And this constellation of skills cuts across school subjects. Mastery over all these four skills is important for the children to gain mastery over the subjects and also to have success at school. In fact, many research studies point out to the fact that achievement in school is directly proportional to the mastery that children have over this constellation of skills. We are not talking about one isolated skill over here. We are talking about all the four skills. And I think as we go along in this program, it will become very clear as to how each and every skill is very important to understand and deepen our understanding of the subject. What else does NCF talk about over here? Let's see this. NCF has very categorically stated that language education is not confined to the language classroom only. Like I said in the beginning, a science, a social science, or a mathematics classroom is as much of a language classroom as the language classroom itself. So once again, it's underscoring the importance that the skills which are integral to language, all the mastery of these four skills is so very important when we are talking about even the teaching of the subject itself. Let's now move on to something more specific. While we recognize that language is very important and the mastery of these skills is also very important, we like to point out your attention and direct your attention to what Paul Nation is talking about in this context. He talks about the four strands of language. And what are the four strands? One is the meaning-focused input, which is learning through listening and reading. Why is it called an input? Because when we listen, this is an input. When we read, that is an input. So he is talking about the meaning-focused input. Here we are talking about learning through listening and reading. Then he is talking about the meaning-focused output. What is meaning-focused output? What is output here? Output is through speaking and through writing. When we speak, that's an output, as compared to when we listen, which is an input, and when we write, again that's an output, as compared to when we read. So we are here talking about the meaning-focused output, which is learning through speaking and writing. Moving on to the next one, Paul Nation is talking that language-focused output means that learning through deliberate attention to language features. What does that mean? It means that when we are teaching, we have to pay significant importance. In fact, we have to deliberately take into account the fact that these four skills also need to be developed simultaneously along with the content. So a deliberate attempt and attention to the development of language features is something which Paul Nation says is of significance. Fluency development, learning through working with known materials across the four skills at a higher than usual level of performance. What is fluency? Fluency, when, how does it come about? Fluency comes about when we do something again and again. When you do things at a repetitive mode, we are building fluency. Let me just go back again to what he is talking about. He is talking about the four strands. What does strands mean here? What is meant by strands? Why are we not calling it features, characteristics, or something other than strands? He calls these four skills as strands because these develop over a period of time. For instance, a child, when he or she joins school, will have basic literacy skills which will be developed a little more further as the child goes into higher and higher classes. So this is a strand which is carried forward. It does not come to an end, but it moves like a thread throughout the school life. So that is why it is called a strand. That is why these skills are called four strands. Now, what does it mean when we are saying meaning focused? Meaning focused means that the teacher deliberately incorporates exercises, activities, and other content area which leads to understanding. It has to be meaningful. Exercises, content, etc. has to be meaningful and, of course, enjoyable to the student. And lastly, like I mentioned earlier, these are strands, and repetitive exercise on these activities is likely to lead to fluency. So the fourth and the last point is, which is a very significant point and where we should aim to take our students, where the student acquires a fluency which actually is higher than the usual level of performance. Let's now also talk about how teachers can actually bring some of these activities into their classroom teaching. What is it that teachers are expected to do? Even though a lot of teachers might say that teaching language is not my cup of tea, it's not my area, it's the area of the language teacher. But I think we want to dispel that notion here. And I would like to request Aisha to talk about how subject teachers in particular, can help the learners to develop these skills, which also will in turn lead to the understanding of the subject itself.
Poonam has explained here the importance of language in learning. So the concept of language across the curriculum that recognizes the central role language plays in learning, all kinds of learning in all subject areas. So subject teachers have to play a major role in student success in different subject areas. Language learning cannot be left to language teachers alone. So we are going to see that how subject teachers can scaffold language learning by students. They can do so by developing in students competency and skills required for comprehending, identifying, selecting, and integrating information. Now, as an example, in a science textbook, if there is experimentation and the teacher is teaching them how to conduct an experiment, it is very important to formulate a hypothesis before you begin an experiment. So it is not so simple for a student. So therefore, the teacher has to teach the student to formulate the correct, the right type of hypothesis relevant to that particular experiment. So this is very important for a science teacher to do so. Then only students can develop that particular understanding or comprehend what a hypothesis is, how an experiment has to be conducted. Or for example, like in a mathematics classroom or in a science classroom, we use graphs quite a lot. Even when we talk about weather prediction or reporting, we use graphs. So students should be taught to extrapolate from graphs. So the teacher has to teach, and the teacher may say it once, but that is not enough for all the students. So some students would need repetition. So the teacher should be mindful of that. By doing so, the teacher can help the student to learn about certain important things relevant to a particular subject area. Now, the next thing the teacher can do is focusing on subject-specific vocabulary. Let me take an example. In a geography classroom, if you are teaching them about volcanoes, how do you begin with that? You may start with the Earth's crust has a lot of chemicals in it. In certain places, there is a lot of accumulation of chemicals, and sometimes these chemicals come into contact with each other and they may start reacting with each other. In this reaction, as a result of the reaction, please note the word, as a result of the reaction, it may generate heat, new compound, and pressure. When these things build up, when the pressure builds up, heat builds up, it may finally erupt. So now we will see that in this particular example, how it is focusing on subject-specific vocabulary. There is content obligatory words. There is content compatible word. Which is the content obligatory word in this example? I said Earth's crust. Then I also said chemicals. I said erupts. These are all content obligatory words. And then I might say when it erupts, lava flows, that is content obligatory word. Pressure, heat, all these are content obligatory words because we are teaching about volcano. And which are the content compatible words? I said as a result of the reaction, heat is generated, pressure is formed, so therefore it erupts. You see the words therefore, as a result, these are content compatible words. So teacher has to be very mindful of the importance of language in teaching different subject areas. Now, moving on to, teacher can also highlight the underlying conceptual framework. Let's take an example. See, if you are teaching photosynthesis, you have learned about concept mapping, so you can create a concept map about photosynthesis. So the major theme and there are sub-themes are connected with arrows, and you show the process. What are the different things you might think here? Photosynthesis is the major concept. Then what are the sub-themes here? There is, you will talk about sunlight, you will talk about chlorophyll, you will talk about trees. So the sub-themes will be in smaller circles, and the major theme, which is the photosynthesis, that is in the bigger circle or in the rectangle. So then with arrows you will be connecting it, meaning you highlight the underlying conceptual framework to understand photosynthesis. What are the other sub-themes the student needs to understand? The teacher will highlight that. There is another way of scaffolding is analyzing subject-specific word formation. Let's see the example. You just see like we use suffixes and prefixes. From the slide here, you can understand like, you know, we very often use a prefix like a bio, and then suffix like a ology, biology, then biography. Then sometimes we use root words like a thermal, geothermal. We know that geothermal station. So these are all like a subject-specific word. The teacher can help students to analyze these subject-specific words and familiarize them with that, so that instead of it becoming a kind of a burden to them, it becomes a very interesting activity. Teachers can also help in scaffolding by developing the ability to focus on the structure of text. Different subject areas, it has its own text structure. Let's see one by one. You will find often cause and effect structure, where informational texts often describe cause-effect relationship. For example, if you are teaching about an earthquake in Japan, why frequent occurrence of earthquake in Japan? So you ask that why. What is the cause? Then the effect. So the critical words you might use here are because, since, if, then, due to, as a result, consequently, etc. So some text may have this kind of a cause-effect structure. For example, another one in chemistry or even in biology, it may be children may come across this. You cut an apple open or a potato, you keep it there in open air for some time, then what happens? It turns brown. So you ask about the cause, then the effect. So text structure can be different. So children have to be, students have to be made aware of that. Now, another text structure is problem and then solving it. The text may describe a problem and then suggest solutions. For example, global warming is a problem. And what are the solutions for it? Or it may be road rage. Or why there is widespread occurrence of diabetes. And the solutions for it. So the critical words here would be propose, conclude, a solution, the reason for, the problem or question. Now moving on to another type of a text structure, that is compare and contrast. In a chemistry classroom, you might teach them about diamonds and graphite, the two different forms of carbon. So you will ask them to compare and contrast. They come from the same root element, carbon, but they are different. So compare and contrast. The difference between hot and cold deserts. So the critical words we use here a, while, yet, but, rather, most, same, either, as well as, like, unlike, as opposed to, etc. may be the critical words used in when we use a text structure that has compare and contrast. Now, another type of a text structure is description. You might describe certain things in detail. For example, your classroom, you may very graphically describe it, that there is a table in the left corner of the classroom. There is a pen on the table. There are 50 chairs in the classroom. So you will keep on graphically describing it. The critical words you use here would be description, adjectives, and words like on, over, beyond, within, etc. We have just given you some examples of how a teacher can scaffold language learning across subject areas. This is not exhaustive. You can have more. We have just given examples. So we were trying to underline the importance of language in learning subject areas, which means the central role language plays in learning and success of students. We would now discuss about registers, and I would request Poonam to give an idea of what are registers when we talk about language.
Yeah, I think it's quite interesting to understand what registers actually are. When we are talking about language, it seems to us that language is language, no? If I want to talk to somebody, I need to formulate my thoughts and so on, and I need to communicate. But have you ever thought that there is a variety of language situations also, and each one of us individually speaks languages in different ways depending on the context and the situation? Let's take a few examples. For instance, do you think that the kind of language I would be speaking when I sit with my friends in a cafe will be the same that I will speak to my professor or my head of the department or the vice chancellor of the university? Think about it. I think it is different. While sitting in a cafe, I think I'm likely to be more casual, take into account the use of slangs also or some other colloquial language. But when I'm talking to my professor, the head of the department, or to the vice chancellor, the use and the choice of words will be different, the style will be different, the tone will be different, and therefore there are differences. Let's try to look at more differences here. How does a child talk to the parent? How does the child talk to the mother and the father? Is there a difference in both situations? And similarly, when we go and ask somebody, when we request somebody to give us something, is the tone different? Is the vocabulary different? Is the style different? The more you think about these situations, the more you will realize that each one of us individually as a person speak different language depending on the social context and the situation. So we have different tones, vocabulary, and styles for each situation, which is different. Let me take you once again to highlight these differences. Let's take a look at the morning newspaper. Have you looked at those pages where we have advertisements? If you recall, a property broker, when he puts up a house for sale, will have a particular kind of language in mind, whereas a matrimonial ad, on the other hand, given in the same paper, is likely to contain a different kind of a tone, and so on and so forth. Similarly, an advertisement for selling something will carry something which is very different. The message here is to persuade people, so it will be more persuasive in its tone, and so on and so forth. So this is an example of everyday life and the different registers, the different language registers that we use in our everyday life. Let me once again transport you to a school. What do we find here? The kind of language which we speak outside a classroom, is it the same that we will speak once we are inside the classroom, a mathematics or an English class is going on, how is the teacher talking to the students, how do the students respond to her, and so on and so forth. Do you think there will be a difference in that kind of a setup, in that kind of a context? I'm sure you will agree that the language which is spoken over there is very different. But what happens most of the time, we carry our everyday language, language that we are familiar with, to the classroom. And because the classroom or the academic language is different, more so in a context where the language of instruction is not our mother tongue, but a different language, more often than not English language, we feel that our everyday language is not helping us to comprehend whatever is being done in the school. So at this point, I think it is important to remember that there are registers. These are called language registers. Everyday registers are very different from academic registers. And let's have a look at how different registers convey the message through a different tone, style, and vocabulary. Let's move on to the other example here. Here we are talking about the weather forecast. All of us make it a point to read the weather forecast in the morning in the newspaper. What does it say? This is again an example of another kind of a register which emanates from our everyday life, and this is with regard to weather. Let us now move to our area of discussion, which is the academic registers. Let us look at how a physics textbook is likely to explain the Dalton's atomic theory. And we've picked this up particularly from the NCERT textbook. Here it is said that according to Dalton's atomic theory, all matter, whether an element, a compound, or a mixture, is composed of small particles called atoms. So in the context of physics, what is being highlighted here when we are talking about atoms? We are talking about an element, we are talking about a compound, we are talking about particles, and we are also talking about atoms. So this is a peep into how the physics register is likely to be in the school context. Let's move a little further and still carry on with that example of the physics and atoms being talked here. The postulates of this theory may be stated as follows. All matter is made of very tiny particles called atoms. Atoms are indivisible particles which cannot be created or destroyed. In the context where we are talking about the conservation of even energy and so on and so forth, we are likely to come across usage of words such as cannot be created or destroyed. So what does this give? What does this example actually point to?
Science textbook, we will notice that when we see the underlined words and sentence, they're either written in simple present tense or in passive voice.
Correct.
So that style is followed in science textbook, because whatever is written in science, it's already based on evidence, established it with proof. So therefore, the language style, by and large, it would be present tense or passive voice.
Correct.
That's why we have underlined
that's
that.
Right. Yeah. I think it's a very important thing that we need to keep in mind, that the discourse of science is very different from social sciences. So language is crucial. Language is an extremely important tool for learning of all kinds.